माला सुधाकुंभ विबोध मुद्रा विद्याविराजत करवारिजाताम अपार कारुण्य सुदाम्बुरासिम श्री शारदाम्बाम प्रणतोऽस्मि नित्यम्। My dear children, I am very happy to be back, to meet you all, and to interact with you for two sessions on issues which are of some public importance, with a clear assurance that these two talks will not be a monologue speech. At every point of time when we cross a concept, let's raise our doubts together. And I'm more interested to know what you feel about these issues as a youngster. Are we so disconnected or are we so connected? That's the challenge. Therefore, I would like to know your views very clearly, and I have taken the mandate from our HOD that these two sessions will have freedom of thought and expressions. He says subject to restrictions, but I would request you to let's understand how far they can go so that we will also travel with them to find out how right they are. I don't have two things I assure you on this topic with all of you. I have not come here with any preconceived notions. Even though I need to state how this issue is evolving, that's my duty. And two, I have not come here to be either pass a judgment or being judgmental over anything. If you do that, then we can't collect ideas. So, the purpose of this interaction is to collect ideas. How does modern India view certain aspects in life? So, the success of these two talks is dependent on your participation. I have prepared very less note sheets. It can't consume more than 30 minutes. So, you have a lot of time left. So your interaction is therefore a necessary ingredient for this talk. I'm very, very happy to be here. Last semester, I normally make at least one lecture a semester. Last semester, I missed it out. And therefore, I'm compensating it with two lectures, one in the morning and one in the afternoon. You will not get bored. I give you that assurance. The design of these two talks, basically, I will explain you the structure so that you can also align yourself. The first talk will have three major components. What is moral reality from India's standpoint of view? Don't think we will be compelling you to do prayer every day, all that. Not that. We are going to discuss concepts. What is moral reality of this nation? How much have we perceived it and how much have we not perceived it? And I am essentially going to speak about this moral reality on the platform and framework of thoughts of Swami Vivekananda. And there is a reason to rely on his teachings. 100 years back, he evolved an India, a new India, a new generation India, and showcased to the world what India, Indians, and Indian values and ethics are to the world, and had the liberty and the assertive mind to speak in world congresses to say that we are the nation who can be the ultimate solution providers for life problems. And when he said so, he was extremely Catholic, so that the whole world was ready to understand, undergo his perspective. Because he did not sensitize any particular school of thought as the school of thought. He brought out what is the need of the hour. And wherever the thoughts may be, let's pull it out, organize it as one world thought for the human race to follow. So, let me narrate what he spoke. And therefore the first milestone we will try to reach is whether these thoughts are outdated or are they relevant. That's the first frame which we need to discuss. But the second phase will be, even though he has not used the expression constitutional morality, he has spoken a lot about nation, nationhood, and citizenship. And while dealing with citizenship, there are chapters where he deals, if you allow, citizenship rights, freedoms, and liberties uncapped, or freedom without restrictions, or freedom without responsibilities, what can happen to your society and nation? He catalogs 5-6 inferences. So let me submit what he says as inferences and let us interact and verify whether they are still suitable today or they are outdated and therefore to be discarded. This will be the second part of this first talk. And the last segment will be, what has Supreme Court originally conceived? What has the Constitution? How does Constitution deal constitutional morality? And how has the Supreme Court been dealing this all along till we came to be given these 5 important judgments last September, October? What were the areas, essentially areas of governance, essentially areas of institutional practice? Now, how does that suddenly got into the bucket call human rights and individual rights? So this will be the contours of the first lecture. The second lecture in the afternoon will deal with the 4 judgments. The rights of LGBT as guaranteed in the Constitution and as exposed by the Supreme Court, very rightly. I think there can be no difference of opinion there at all. So what does and how does Supreme Court deal with that subject? How did it reverse Kaushal? And why did it reverse Kaushal and on what basis? Then from there we move on to Joseph Schein, the adultery judgment. And let me bring out certain perspectives of how Justice Malhotra and Nariman deal it from a pure perspective of law and how yet another judge develops it into a private right. And we need to interact there to find out whether an adulterous life can be considered as a constitutional guarantee. Can a constitution guarantee adultery as a right, as a fundamental right? That is something which we need to, I want to understand your views. Before coming over here, I had an interaction with my own juniors, both boys and girls, and showed them the passages of the judgment and said, will you be a consenting adult to your spouse? Because Supreme Court says that's the only way out, otherwise it is divorce. So they were all virtually baffled, to be very honest. So let me understand whether, to what extent, I will explain to you the content of the judgment. I'm not sure how many would have read it line by line. I'll explain you the context and the content. And so these 2 judgments on whether adultery can be a constitutional guarantee. Then we move on to the later 2 judgments, Sabarimala, that's under review. So I'll just only narrate to you What were the positions we have taken in review for, because it's a law university, I'm entitled to narrate what was argued. Because it's under review, we can't be debating it beyond a point. So we will deal with Sabarimala and the Aadhaar judgment. Because in this four, it is only Aadhaar which stands as an exception. It says, you can't allow, as what HOD was saying 10 minutes before, you can't allow individual liberties uncapped. Individual liberties are subject to communitarian values. So you have two conflicting views of the Supreme Court of benches of equal strength. One saying individual liberty will overarch and subsume any other guarantees under the Constitution, even if it is fundamental in nature. Yet another Supreme Court judgment of 5 judges say, no, no, individual liberties are subject to communitarian value. Therefore, we need to deliberate as students of law which of the two could be possibly right in the long run. So this will be the course syllabus for the next two talks. I hope you are okay with this. Basic guideline is fine. Right. Now let's understand what is moral reality about. Swami Vivekananda takes the subject called education. He says, a nation's success, strength, or its brittleness depends on how it defines education. And says, can we deal education in the following flow? You are first born as a child to your parents. You don't go to a school the day you are born. You are nurtured for the first few years by your parents. Now, of course, by outsourced to crutches. But somebody has to nurture the child. And then it goes into an institution. Then as it grows, it also interacts with the society. And as it evolves, it gets married, it creates a family of its own, and then starts moving in progressing in life. Before the journey of this human body comes to an end or gets terminated. So, let's take the map. As a child, as an adult, as an adolescent, as an adult, as a youth, and as one who progresses in old age. Are we not connected, whether you want it or not, are we not connected with something called a family system? Something called a society? Something called the institution of marriage? So he puts the first question as, life learning experiences are drawn or gained only from these three institutions by any human being. You can't be understanding emotional life in a college. College has its own text, its own syllabus, its own examinations. It needs to prepare you as a good lawyer. So, the emotional strength, the emotional ups and downs, the emotional experiences of life is taught to every individual only upon his interaction with his own family, with his own society, with his own nation, and through the process of his own marriage and creating his own family. And therefore, if you want something to be a continuing education, education as a life science, the question that we need to ask, which he asked to the world, was, will you confine it to a block of buildings, a set of textbooks, a set of examinations, or will you open up yourself for experiencing the world from these institutions which exist for time immemorial, all parts of the world. There may be rare exceptions in some human race in some forbidden forest, but generally civilization, in any general civilization of any part of the world, has these three institutions forming the fulcrum called a nation. What is a nation? Nation is not simply borders. So a nation comprises of these three institutions. And therefore, the emotional life and experiences of individuals, are they relevant or not in your progress towards life? That's the first question. Because today, you must be aware, as you progress more and more in life, you will be undergoing a lot of interviews. You will meet with people. Today, modern interviews are no longer IQ-based. Gone are those days. IQ is intelligent quotient. How intelligent you are was how you were gauged some years back. Today, interviews all over the world is based on EQs. How strong is your emotional quotient? Unless your emotional quotient is balanced, it is in equilibrium, it is in sensible perceptions, then you won't be able to meet those challenges that you may have to confront in the course of your employment. So emotional quotient is something, a derivative, not from a university syllabus. I think, do you all agree on this point or is there a disagreement? I want to first understand before we progress to the next frame of mind. Do you agree emotional quotient and emotional experiences are of paramount importance as we grow as a human personality? Say yes or say no loudly.
Yes.
I hope there is no dissent at all on this. Can I take it that there are no dissent? Is there a dissent on this? Yeah, I'm happy. So it's not a majoritarian influence on you. Constitution prohibits majoritarian, authoritarian impositions. So therefore, it is not a majoritarian view, it's an unanimous view of this house to say that we need these three institutions which gives us the emotional life. All right. Now, he then progresses to say, if you have so, what should be the content of your educational syllabus, not university? When I say education, what Swami Vivekananda says is not writing exams. Education as an ongoing experiment on yourself. You and your education. That's how he perceives it. He takes every individual. He asserts he is one person who brought out the concept of individuality, which was otherwise hidden in the society. He was one who promoted individuality 100 years back. He was concerned ultimately about an individual's happiness, an individual's priority in life, and an individual's liberty in life, individual's dignity in life. But when he decided to promote individual liberty and dignity, his syllabus contained a few aspects and perspectives. So in 2019, we need to understand whether these perspectives are needed or not. So we first, there's an agreement amongst us, marriage, society and family are indispensable institutions. Good. Now, then we progress to the next stage. He says, in your curriculum of life, should you not be focusing on four elements? He identifies the four elements: physical, intellectual, emotional, and ethical. He says, you create, he makes a clear distinction. How does an individuality becomes a personality? What is transformation through education? That was the question the world put to him. You're talking all this. Put us in one sentence. You are saying there must be a transformation. Transformation means what? Transforming whom to what? And he had a one-line answer. I'm talking of an individual dignity and individual liberty, and how an individual can transform into a great human personality. So whether you should remain as an individual or you should convert yourself as an individual personality, that's the question. If you agree that we should become a personality of our own, then he says your educational perspective should be, you must have four components as your basis in your life: physical, intellectual, emotional, and ethical. And he says the first two, you learn it through a system called education, through a system called a curriculum. Both your intellectual education and your physical education, sports, good nourishment, all this is being taught everywhere. And intellectual, making you intellectually strong on certain talents, certain skills, certain abilities, and certain domain subjects of knowledge. This is something a university can impart to you. But when it comes to the other two components, namely the emotional and ethical integration, he says you need to fall back again on these three sacred holy institutions called marriage, society, and family. It is they who can supplement you and educate you and impregnate on you emotional values and ethical values. What do you mean by ethical? We'll go to concentrated ethicality in the afternoon session. Basic ethics, trying to be human, first of all. Will you adjust with your sister? Or you keep on fighting even against her, saying that my individual liberties are sacrosanct to me? Will you compromise for something for the sake of your brother? Will you yield something for the sake of your parents? Or say, come what may, my liberties are far supreme and sacrosanct, and get lost, you guys. I don't want you in my life. Therefore, these two aspects, all the four according to him, makes a personality. When the next step he takes on this is, if you have all the four components, it's a beautiful derivative he conceives. He says, any human being who adapts all these four components as part of his personality, he will be able to identify a surplus in him as a human personality. He says that is the derivative. What is the advantage of doing this? After all, we ask, when I do something, what will come to me in return? It's a very simple expectation. He gives that assurance. He says, if you integrate all these four into your life, you will be able to identify what is surplus in you. What do you mean by surplus? It can be a surplus of wealth. It can be a surplus of knowledge. It can be a surplus of time. It can be a surplus in terms of physical competence. And it can be a surplus of any other form. Then he says, once you identify the surplus, if you have a good emotional background and a good educational background, you will be driven to think, how do I employ the surplus in life? Should I use the surplus for my personal gains? Or should I integrate the surplus for human society and human service? Good emotional life makes you to renounce. Good emotional life will tempt you to serve the society, because good emotions give you lot of strength and energy internally. That is his objective. So every human being, you apply your mind calmly and quietly and discuss among your own friends. Give your time. After 1 month, find out, has God left any surpluses with you? You will be driven to identify your surpluses. You will have one. He says, no human being is left without surpluses. It's a question of identifying the surplus. So, this process then happens as the next derivative. Then he says, if you move forward with this integration of all these four components, they generate three invaluable outputs to you: ethical awareness, social connect, and humanistic values. If you have a good emotional life, if you have a good education, and if you combine this, you will turn out to be extremely humanistic. And the final point, which the destination he says is, you will see the difference between organic satisfaction and value satisfaction. That's the balance sheet which each and every individual here has to draw. What do you mean by organic satisfaction? Satisfying bodily and sensual desires. Keep on working towards that. Pleasures in life. Whereas value satisfaction is something which generates a lot of peace, a lot of happiness, and you vibrate love slowly to others. In fact, the concept of universal love, all of us, when freedom of expression, the first line they speak, whoever wants to, whichever side they take on freedom of expression, we want to see universal love to be achieved. You can achieve universal love only when you have ethical integration. Only when you have an emotional quotient for you. And you realize life is not organic. Life is not merely biological. Life is beyond human biology. There's a mind to the life. There is a sense of an integration in the form of a society to the life. And therefore, life is a value quotient and not an organic quotient. So, we have moved to the second frame. Now my questions, I want to take questions. Do we agree on this premise of Vivekananda? Or do we have to say life is only organic, life is only pleasures, it's immaterial, life cannot be value, there need not be any ethics to life, there need not be any emotions to life? Which of the two views do you subscribe? Let me put it on vote for yes or no. Do you agree we need all these four, namely physical, intellectual, emotional, and ethical integration? Or do you say emotional and ethical integration is not required at all for a man's life? Yes or no? Which, for yes for what? Can we say these four are indispensable? I want you to interact freely. I've taken the mandate. So if you have anything to subscribe, I've come here to learn. Please let us interact and debate. I have no problem about it. Yeah, please. I'm happy. Can somebody give her a mic? Yeah. So, for the benefit of one and all, I'll put the question, which is, she says, does not a rational decision making, a rational performance of activities, derive a great satisfaction? It gives you immense satisfaction to you. So, why not that constitute the basis for human life? Have you put the question correctly to your satisfaction? Right? Okay. Now let's deal this question. What do you mean by rational? Rational is using the power of intelligence, using the power of your strength in the form of skills or talents, whatever manifests in you visibly. Have I defined it correctly? Right. Now, are you ready to take up failures in life with a smile? That's the first counter question I'm going to ask. Because the young children today who go to school, who are all cajoled on the theory of rationality, the child should have everything, it should be individual, it should enjoy, it should do anything. The moment it makes a small slip or a fall down, the child is not able to accept any defeat in life. So, rationality gives you joy, undoubtedly. As long as you keep performing, as long as you are able to achieve the results of your defined purposes. That's the strength of rationality. See, nothing is without strength. That's why I said I'm not judgmental, I'm not come here to condemn. No, not at all. Please feel free to interact. I've come here to learn as much as you think you can learn something out of this talk. So rationality encourages you to work, it encourages you to sweat better, encourages to have perseverance, all that I agree. But rationality, because of absence of emotional integration and ethical quotient to it, if you fail on your attempt, you simply break down most often. The fact, if you say, no, I don't break down, I'm quite courageous, I take life in its own style, then you have to concede to the fact your rationality has indeed an emotional quotient to it. Somewhere you have been trained to think emotionally, that your ownership is only pertaining to rights and you are not a owner for your results. Emotions and good integration, compromises, high level of cohesiveness, all this produces you a thought that you are a owner to your work, you are owner to your effort, but you are not a owner to your results, because results, according to rationality, I have put an effort, it should produce result. That's how rationality works. It doesn't work that way. Does world order work that way? World order never works that way. Every effort doesn't turn into a success. So what is that missing quotient? Missing quotient, philosophers will call it karma. Modern Swami Vivekananda will say, have the courage to face it. Then he will slowly take you to teach what karma is. So the answer to your question is, it's all fine till you succeed. This rationality doesn't work in a situation of failure. And life is a combination of both. And therefore you need a family, you need a society, you need a marital association to lean back. Somebody to whom you can share anything you want comfortably. See, the relationship of a husband and wife is so unique in any system of marriage. You can't generalize that relationship with any other relationship. It's impossible. You go and discuss with the most, a couple which fights the most. Go and talk with them. The indispensability, the emotional indispensability of the life partner. 7 out of 10 cases. See, there may be today divorces are all on the increase for a different reason. We can discuss it at a later point of time. But marriage as an institution, as a platform, has its own emotional strength. So, do you agree rationality has this downside? You agree? Thank you so much. So why don't you clap for this? I'm happy. I want to know your name. Subiksha. Her question is not absurd. We should value her question, because that is the basic thought that is running in the youth's mind. After all, I can read. The world is seen, visualized as a material perception. I'm able to see what I will perceive what I see. It all starts with that. Seeing is truth. Seeing is correct. And perception drawn out of my own seeing, my own understanding is therefore correct. See, this is how rationality is built. So it is centered around your intelligence, your capability, your ability to assimilate, and your ability to connect and draw up an inference. You can go right, you can go wrong. Because human experiences cannot be just a composition of a single individual act or perception. It has several. That's why, see, when you discuss, you go and tell your parents, I want to marry this guy. Parents ask certain preliminary questions. Will he? Why? Because they are, after all, you are their child. Will he keep you happy? That's the first question they ask. So they want a rational answer, an emotional connect to say, how do you say that he will be able to ensure a good life for you? So can you say, this is a stupid question, I know how to deal with my life? Can we say, can that be a reply to your parents? That's the question. So whether you have to be rational or you have to integrate, that's the point. Okay, good. So we left here. Life can't be merely organic satisfaction. Life has to be a value satisfaction. That's how you move into life. Then he says, after this, Swami Vivekananda is one who has dealt the aspect of secularism in a classical way. If somebody wants to understand, especially you as lawyers, if you want to know secularism, read every form of school of secularism. Absolutely. See, you must be exposed to every thought. Don't shut your eyes. Don't shut your ears. Listen to every thought. Understand everything. But you must be able to know what is correct or what is wrong, for which your understanding of the whole perspective is important. Don't derive your own conclusions based on your own imperfect knowledge or imperfect understanding. That's the only caution we every time a classical school gives to rationalists. Don't be adamant. Don't be inflexible. Don't be impolite. Don't be harsh to holding to your views, to say rest of the views. And the final conclusion, they say, I'm entitled to my view, you're entitled to view. All of us can have our own views. And we enter conversation there. That's the best way to break. How do you break? Get lost here. I know you have your view. We are entitled to our views. This is how we populate ideas. We don't integrate ideas. Swami Vivekananda believes in integrating ideas. Either of us, one of us should be more relatively right in any issue. I may be right in some issue. You may be right in some other issue. I need not be right always. You need not be right always. So unless this cohesiveness happens, how do you generate a good society? That's the question. So, when he deals with secularism, he gives, according to me, we have read, after researching enough of this thought in various cross-sections of views, his view appears to be the best. According to me, you can add or you can contest, so that I will learn if there is something more to add to it. He says, what is secularism? Preserve your religious practices. Preserve your caste practices within your house. Don't bring it to public domain. See the formula. He doesn't say give up your religion. Today, what people in the name of secularism are preaching to all of us, becoming irreligious is secularism. You can never reach secularism by being irreligious. Because if you become irreligious, you become only intolerant. You become only egoistic. You become only self-conceived. No compromise. So, secularism is not making people irreligious. It is making people religious to ensure they respect every form of faith, including non-believers. That's his faith. But to say non-believers are right, and that is the faith, rest is all not faith, that needs to be subsumed, is secularism, is not correct. So this is the first aspect he brings it out. Close your religion and caste practices, lock it under key in your house. When you come to public domain, because the constitution guarantees you equal rights. It's an egalitarian constitution. It gives equal opportunities for everybody to contest everything. So where do you need that tag? Why do you need that tag anymore when you come into public domain? That's the question. So does it not function well? You don't have to spread hatred or love or any sense. Why should we talk religion in public domain? Or keep interact? Constitution says you can propagate, profess, these conversions, all this happen only under these constitutional guarantees. Where is the need to bring this into public? You can have it your own way and style. That was his principle for one of the principal aspects of secularism. Then he said, he escalates it into a more refined subject, spiritual life at home. Material, yeah, please. Take your mic. So that everybody hears you. Put your name, please state your name.
I'm Shiva from first year BA LLB. My question is that what will happen if a certain religion prescribes that the religion should be brought into the public domain?
See, now, that I think it's a brilliant question. In fact, most of the religions may say so. That is why I said Swami Vivekananda is very Catholic. Now you will understand my statement. He never borrowed anything completely from any particular religion. He never evidenced his philosophy based on one particular religion. He generalized it. He took the best of everything and integrated it as what is good for the human race. So therefore he said, if somebody is going to recommend that as a part of their religion, in 2019 it's not going to work. You then start a non-secularistic view only in that, because see, the more we discuss religion in public domain, it leads to more problems. As sensible human beings, we should refrain from discussing religion in public domain. I'm just making a request to all of you. Wherever I go, I always tell children, give peace a chance. Give harmony a chance. Life is wonderful when you are peaceful. An agitated mind, an inflexible mind, an intolerant mind cannot be very happy always. Therefore, the answer could be, it is not advisable to do it in public domain. That's exactly what Swami Vivekananda recommends. Close it at home. So this is the second step. Now the third, yeah, please. Subiksha, give her the mic. Feel free. We have time.
It's just that you said that talking about religion in a public forum is not advisable, given that it may lead to intolerance. But you've also said that through following your religion, not just in your home, but outside as well, you start to understand, through religion, you understand secularism. So isn't that a little contradictory?
See, very simple. If you are in a state of equanimity, then any discussion is okay. Any discussion is okay. But when you are in a situation, see, you cross through an experience in life. We are talking about 2019. The public domain is so infected, so affected, so contaminated with hatred through religious discourse. In that scenario, is Swami Vivekananda not right what he said 100 years before? Shut it at your home. When you come to public domain, don't open your mouth. Is he wrong?
He's not wrong. I agree with him in the sense that even when we make laws, most of our laws regarding marriage and divorce are still based on your religion, and that should come, and the whole religion factor should come out of it. So I do agree with Swami Vivekananda there, but I also feel at some point that the more we discuss, at some point, the more awareness is created.
See,
probably.
It's a question of the era. Discussion in public domain spreads awareness is a definite theory. But when the public domain is infested only with contaminated matter, especially in the case, see, caste and religion are the two easiest thing to contaminate in public domain to influence democratic results. It's the easiest vehicle. And we are suffering out of that all these years. So, should you not rethink, at least in your generation? See, all of you are classmates, all of you are batchmates, all of you belong to the same university. How many times you would have fought with each other on religious faith and religious discourses? You would not have. But the moment you step out of it, or when you are in your own private domain with a set of people, you WhatsApp hate messages, you forward hate messages. You feel that you have to take one side or the other. How many times you have done it with your own colleagues? You would not have done it. Because you basically want peace. So you feel, talking this to my close friend will disrupt the relationship. But WhatsApping that to 100 people also disrupts. See, these people are succeeding. You should understand, the fellow who puts the first hate message, you are actually caving in. By start forwarding it 100 times, 1,000 times, and 1,000,000 times, you have supported and his mission is achieved. He has ensured hate message reaches 10 lakh people. Am I right? Should we not stop that? Why should we? What? At least take a vow that you can, when you forward a message, let it give happiness and peace to the recipient. Let it not give hatred. Swami Vivekananda says, love is life, hatred is death. By hating, the first sufferer will be the person who hates before it injures somebody else. So never hate anybody in life. That's a commitment as children. You should have it as your philosophy of life. How can we hate a human being? Yeah? On what basis can we hate? So hatred should get out of our system. And hatred will get out of your system only when you have a good emotional balance, not out of rationality. Rationality, it will also rationalize hatred and say, conceptualize, well, hatred is a point of view, you know. It develops this in the society, you know, lecture kudupanga. We should not fall a victim to that. That's the point I'm trying to. Any questions? Yeah.
Sir, I have a doubt. It's not very related to what you said, but then it is a point connected to what you said, sir. If you are going
even
to,
if it is not connected, no problem. Don't hesitate.
Yes, sir, if you're saying that religious practices are supposed to be done inside your house, doesn't that also mean that you are trying to restrict other cultural practices that are related to the religion?
See,
which is like for example, in the name of secularism. Carnatic music is regarded not belonging to Hinduism. Correct. Per se. Does it, is that a show of secularism?
No, when I say, I think it's a good question. See, I'm not now conducting a class of classifying what should be religious faith at home and what should be other than religious faith in public domain. I'm not doing that. I'm not doing that dissection today. Conceptually, don't take a subject which can lead to confrontation. Don't debate a subject which can sow the seeds of hatred. Carnatic music doesn't sow hatred anywhere. You may dislike a musician, you may even condemn a musician for his rhetoric. But that doesn't develop as a hatred against that music or hatred against a religion. Whereas core religious thoughts and core religious experiences today develops, spreads a lot of hatred. I'm talking of today's era. As children, when you pass through this phase, I don't want you to suffer this mutilation in your emotional quotient. You should be able to love anybody as good human beings and evolve a better, strong, cohesive, unified force. Not for you understand the purpose. This is exactly what a man has said 100 years. See, I'm not saying anything on my own. I'm too small a fellow to say. I'm only borrowing an idea and I'm also saying who's the author of the idea. But 100 years back, he has conceived what is suited in 2019. That is what I'm trying to... I was wondering, when I started reading him to capture the notes for this talk, I was stunned. His gospel truths will remain eternally imperishable and it will work at all points of time in any society. That's how it is designed. Because human feelings normally progress in a particular scale and in a particular style. Right? Okay. So now, please. Take your mic. We have restricted it to one mic to restrict one question at a time.
Sir, from what I've understood from this ideology, and sir, do correct me if I'm wrong with my regarding the understanding.
You can be wrong also, feel free. You are a lawyer. First understand, don't hesitate. Speak whatever you feel.
So from what I've understood is that the ideology propagates the fact that we should rather not get into a conflict than confront it head on. What I feel the ideology propagates is that to me, secularism promotes tolerance. And if we confide our religious practices and our the uniqueness of my religion to the four corners of my home, this is me and not bringing it to the public domain. It promotes ignorance rather than tolerance, because if I don't showcase the uniqueness of my religion to others and the fact that in the public domain, if I cannot practice my religion along with that of another religion together in harmony, that is what tolerance is to me. Good, and that is good. What secularism is
understand,
to me.
Understand. Perfect. So she says, bringing it in public establishes harmony. Please, I'll ask a counter question. Today we have technology. Everything can be put in a platform. Go back to your grandma's days. What did she exhibit in public domain? And was she not more religious than your mom? And was she not more religious than you? Why? Always, religion ultimately is customized to what is called as a family practice in India. Kula Varakkam, Abdin Solrome. This Kula Varakkam is a combination of your caste and religious practices. It applies even to Abrahamic religions, not confined only to a Hindu. Therefore, it is so customized between one family and the other family, even though they belong to the same religion, the house practices will have variation. It is so customized. You go and ask your grandmother, what did she exhibit in public domain? Nobody exhibited anything. My cousin has come from a village. I'm saying all this because I still have an orientation with my village. Therefore, I'm talking from that strength. See, Karupanna Sami is a deity most known in all villages. Morning, 9 o'clock, people will offer Sakara Pongal as Nevidyam. 2 o'clock, meat and eggs as Nevidyam. And evening, liquor and bidi or surutu as Nevidyam. So one God, different practices. We have achieved cohesiveness. Our society has achieved this cohesiveness centuries back. Because everybody respected their own practices and everybody homogenized their practices on one particular idol. You go and see in a village, this is a practice in most, at least it is there in my village. I can say this with assurance. Therefore, integration is possible. That integration doesn't, when I say in public domain, integrating in public domain is different from exhibiting in public domain. When you start exhibition, then exhibition generates heat. It doesn't generate light. Religion generates light through a personal pursuit. It doesn't generate light in a collective endeavor. Collective endeavor of a religious practice generates only heat. It doesn't generate light. We have never done such things in the past. Today everything is, I do it, you do it, you do it, I do it. It's a counter. And it escalates again and again. And when you look back to the statement of Swami Vivekananda, who said 100 years back, keep it there, you will have a more harmonious society. Is he not right if you test it in 2019? That's the question I'm putting to you. Right? Okay. Now, this is one, please, you want to ask? Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir.
Let's manage with one mic. Maybe one mic for this section, one mic. Otherwise, two questions at a time. Yeah.
I have one question, sir. So now there is a belief or a practice that I think I should follow to be true to my religion. If I'm going to limit that to my house or to the four corners of my house, and I am now in a public domain, and if I do not follow that particular belief or practice, am I not restricting myself from...
See, when I say, I think the question is understood very clinically. When I say, don't bring religion into public, don't discuss it, don't debate it, don't create thoughts of... make it a contentious, debatable issue in public domain. I'll put it in that short space. Have you done it? You have not done it. What I'm trying to say, are you engaging in your daily routine? How many hours or minutes do you spend every day to stand up in public domain and argue your religion is most superior? You don't do it at all. You never do it. That's what I'm trying to say. But you don't mind forwarding a message 100 times. Which messages can only instigate hatred. That's the point I'm trying to. I'll put it in that narrow a campus rather than trying to dissect which portion of religion is within house, which portion, and the marina pirikila. That's not what I'm trying to. Yes. Yeah. You won't be heard. Give her the mic. Yeah.
With respect to an individual's perspective and considering their emotional quotient, wouldn't it be better for them to be exposed to different perspectives and then decide which practice would be better suited for them? If we were to restrict it within the four corners, they wouldn't be exposed to various practices. So shouldn't it be up to the individual to first debate and determine what's right for them?
See, I want to go with an empirical data because I'm applying now, not emotion. I am applying your school of thought of rational approach. Please tell me, by exposing it to multiple thoughts, how many have either aligned themselves with the religions to which they belong, or how many have migrated to other religions, and what is the empirical data you have in public domain to say, by arguing this or debating it or exposing it in public domain, it encourages a beautiful cohesion and harmony. You don't have an empirical data. Whereas I can give you empirical data to the contrary. That's the point. So we must, even a rational application, see, Angada, that rationality is subject to the understanding that should we penetrate still, no, my view is this has to be exposed. Or no, this exposure has led to these consequences. So is exposure good or bad? That's the question I want you to ask. I have empirical data to say it has spread only hatred. So let's not do it. Right? Enough on this, so we'll move to the next frame. So now we'll consolidate this. He says a combination of all this results in a good emotional balance for a human being. And when it comes to secularism, this is one cardinal rule. Along with secularism, I want to add one dimension on globalization. This is our value addition, because Swami Vivekananda never had a chance to speak globalization then. His globalization was of a different era. I'm making a request to all the children here. See, if somebody is going to say globalization is bad and you should oppose globalization, it's madness. Because globalization has done so much to the world in terms of technology, in terms of employment, in terms of progress. It has done several things. So there are lot of advantages which each one of you can exploit out of globalization. I give you the assurance. I'm one person who has done it. I can share my personal experiences on that. But you must follow one formula when it comes to globalization. Globalization is like a pair of slippers. You should leave them at your doorsteps and not take it into your home. When it comes to religion, I'm saying don't take it to the public domain. When it comes to globalization, values relating to globalization, please don't allow it to invade your homes. your homes will go for a toss. If you have these two norms in life, your life will be a very healthy life. Practice at home. Be a citizen in the public domain. Encourage, exploit, use the advantages of globalization, but leave it at the doorsteps. You don't allow your value systems to be corroded with globalized progress. Progress out of globalization can give you only material benefits. Globalization will not make you a superior atma. It won't make you into a more evolved spiritual person. It has no such clues. It can only make you materially happy. So you shouldn't be materially happy. But because you can be materially happy, don't think the flip side of globalization is also good for you. Then three judgments which we are going to discuss in the afternoon, I will show you the flip sides of globalization. That's the point I want to pitch. So don't take globalization into your home. If you have these two topics, two thoughts in your mind, then possibly you can move to the next frame of thought, a better frame of mind, where you will consider, see, today you are individuals, you are youngsters. At some point of time, you'll go for an employment or get into the profession. You will create a family for yourself. You will create people around you. You will be part of the society and for some cause of service. Something will happen to you, all of you. So, these two points, according to Swami Vivekananda, a good secularist is what I've defined. I've now added the dimension of globalization. If you have these two frame of mind, you will always consider family and marital institutions are the indispensable nursery for any human being. He uses this word, indispensable nursery of human morals and human values. That's the necessary, inevitable result one will reach. He gives that assurance. And he says, now you wanted to ask a question. We were asking a lot of questions about public domain. What to say, what not to say, how to define, what not to define. 1300 years back, our philosophers have classified human race into four broad categories. No Varna system, no Ashrama system. This classification of four is completely different. They say you can classify human race into four broad buckets. The Mahapurushas, who are yogis, saints, that category. People who are disconnected with the world. That's one section. The second is Samanya Purushas. People who are ready to come forward and help the society as long as it doesn't pinch them. As long as I don't suffer anything, I'm ready to come and help. Then the third category is one. I will do something in the society to derive a selfish benefit for myself. I'm not bothered about if society is affected in the process or not. That is the third category of human beings. And the last human beings, whether it is good or bad, I will destroy the society, its equilibrium, its environment, every damn thing, even if I don't derive anything out of it. Antisocials. So, these are the four broad, at every point of time, every nation will have these four sets of people. It's inevitable. But how do you gauge the health of a nation? He says, the health of a nation is gauged as long as the first and the last category remain as microscopic minority, then to a greater extent you are safe. You can't have too many people as yogis, then it will only be a case of fraud. Because it's not that easy to become a yogi. You can't also have too many antisocial elements occupying the society. If there is going to be an increase in the percentage of antisocial elements, then it is a case for concern for that nation. So 1 and 4 has to be at the barest minimum. And 2 and 3, whether you help for your own benefit or you help in an unselfish way, it depends on the texture of the nation. A nation where the maximum population belongs to the second category will always remain a stable nation. As long as you can keep increasing the bandwidth in the second category, that nation will be a strong and a superior nation for times to come. So, as youth, don't you have a responsibility to contribute your might, either between the second category or the third category, to start with? You start with even the third category. Can you slowly endeavor to reach the second category and keep increasing its bandwidth? So, this is the foundation I lay to you. Till now, are there any disputes, or are there any doubts, or are there any issues to be resolved? I'll give you a final round of questioning for next 5 to 10 minutes, and then I'll wind up in the next 10 minutes of this first talk. Do you have any questions now? Or can I say that up to this, there is an agreement amongst us? Can I take it that there is an agreement? Oh yeah, please.
I'll connect two heads, which is antisocial elements and keeping your religion at home. Let's assume a scenario where there are
I hope you don't say keeping religion at home is antisocial.
Definitely not. Okay. So I'm assuming a scenario where there are a couple of antisocial elements who are going against your religion in public domain. So in that scenario, are you expected to protect your religion at home, or are you expected to actively take it to public domain and protect your religion? My question one. Two, going strictly by the mandate for the past 5-10 minutes that you should keep it at home and not propagate anything on public domain to save it, aren't we succumbing to the thought that we are allowing other folks to exploit our religion? So how do you answer that question?
I understand. I'll answer it in a in a rather direct way. In fact, we are now doing some work. We are planning to contribute some articles for the purpose of these elections in a very, very neutral way. As lawyers, we discovered Supreme Court has said so many things about voting right, and the democratic values around the elections. So much of discourses. One of them being nota. Now, nota is a valuable right for any voter. If he dislikes all the contesting candidates, he can put nota. Perfect. But the downside of nota, if you see, is if nota doesn't constitute the majority, if nota constitutes the majority, you actually throw all the candidates out because you are frustrated with the kind of fellows who are contesting. Then nota subserves its objective. But by voting into nota, you don't constitute the majority. You are actually succumbing to some fellow winning the election anyhow. Your vote becomes a waste. So, is it appropriate to use nota in this election? That's the question. How crucial it is? How crucial is your vote? That is the. Now, this is the type of answer. Now, when he says somebody is bringing something in public domain, when I say don't take it out, this must be a fundamental aspiration for all human beings. I'm not saying do it from tomorrow, do it from yesterday, no. Is it not the path which we should progress so that you guys live a life in peace and harmony, which we have not enjoyed much? The kind of the ups and downs all of us have gone in 50 years of our human existence, this is something which you need not undergo. Because you are evolving, because you're all becoming very rational. And therefore, I'm requesting you, should you not? So unless there is a consensus amongst all, it's like nota. If one fellow says, I'll keep, the other fellow will come and only exploit it. So this is an evolving theory which I wanted to put it as a thought process, number one. Number two, this is my answer for conversion. If let's take conversion as a question. What do we do? Whoever converts, whoever doesn't convert, how do we meet that challenge when there is a forced conversion, which is not a constitutional guarantee? My answer has always been, have you done enough for those people in your religion? Because my driver, in spite of 10 times being persuaded to be converted, he has not converted. My servant maid, in spite of being enticed with lot of money and lot of assurances, has not converted. And it is these sets of people who are normally prone to a conversion process. So, if you diagnose what is the problem, today, if companies, employees, institutions are ready to take care of all of them with their families, celebrate few of the festivals collectively, give them the share of representation to participate. The flowers in our house is everyday purchase, assorted, kept ready only by my servant maid. I want her to involve in some form of a religious activity. So, if you involve them in your religious enterprise, give them an opportunity to participate, bring them on board, make them feel that they are towards God. This is one of the aims and ambitions and visions of Swami Vivekananda. He said, and he sees our religion, any religion for that matter, has to be Catholic. It gives a right to reach to God to everybody. Take any caste. Have we not seen people from all the caste, all the ashramas, reaching God? They've attained godhood in their own life. So, you become caste-based when you apply the same logic to a material warfare. Then it becomes a caste issue. In a religious pursuit, nothing is a problem. That's the digestion which we are not able to align in a social thought process. So my submission, my request to all of you is, try to promote. So how do you stop conversion? Ensure people of your own clan partake in religious activities, in activities which can instill faith, confidence and happiness and a great sense of participation. This is one. Two, as he was putting across, if somebody occupies and then starts spreading hatred, somebody occupies and starts converting, somebody occupies and starts fighting, the answer is this. See, suppose there's a war. Are we supposed all of the entire 120 billion will go and wage war? We can't do that because we don't know how to wage a war. So now, suppose there's an internal disturbance of a civil nature. Can the entire society stand up and say, we will solve the problem? You can't solve the problem. See, these people are succeeding only there. What is civil unrest? Creating the minds, creating agitation in a human mind is civil unrest. So, you populate a human mind with unrest. Then it triggers. Then the trigger becomes a fire. You fumigate, you spread, you infect, then it becomes a social disturbance. None of you should be a victim to this trap, is what I'm trying to say. You're all intelligent lawyers in the future. Don't get emotionally blacklisted. Be sensible. There is a problem, and therefore the problem needs to be handled with a solution. The solution is not Everybody is standing up and shouting at the problem. Have you solved it? You have not solved it. And therefore, I'm discouraging you a discourse in public domain. That's the purpose. Okay. Now, any questions? Last 10 minutes. Then we go 10 to 15 more minutes. Okay, fine. I'm happy then. Yes. Please ask. Oh, yeah. Mike.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Abhishek, a final year student. Sir, I seek your permission to ask two questions.
One without permission, you can ask two questions.
Yes. My first question is a personal question, which is with respect to the emotional quotient and rationality. I think I'm actually speaking for most of us in the house that I find it to be a gray area with few individuals having a brighter stroke of emotional quotient and a few having a brighter stroke of rationality. So sometimes we tend to not find which area we're supposed to be in while taking a decision. And that's where most of us get confused and end up taking a hasty decision, or rather a decision which might turn out to be not in our favor. So how do we strike a balance rather to find out what should be our intention, rather our idea, when we think about something to take a decision? That's my first question. Second, about public domain and religion. We spoke about us practicing religion at home within the four corners and all that. How do we apply Swamiji's principle when, say, a government uses the text of a constitution to impose certain principles of particular religion on a huge country, in the case of a democratically elected government in a secular country?
See, your constitution guarantees propagation and professing a religion as a constitutional right. I'm not disagreeing there. It's a constitutional right. And that's why many people profess. I'm only saying, contextually, this professing of religion has only led to more and more hatred and more tug of war. You have a guarantee and therefore you will do it. That's the question. So my answer to that question is, you will understand, though not now, you are all in a very protected environment today. As you move more and more in the world, you will feel this heat and challenge hitting on you. Then you will have to take a call. I would request you not to give an emotional backlash of coming up on stage and delivering hate speeches. Please don't do it. Hatred is no solution to any problem. God will not support one who hates. He will drop you like a hot potato. And society also will not support hatred beyond a point. Hatred is not a solution. That is the answer to the second question. Now the answer to the first question is, I agree. See, some will have an emotional quotient deficiency at home. Some will have an emotional quotient deficiency with society. So one thing I have found out, Abhishek, in my life, if you are deficit somewhere, God gives you an opportunity of compensation somewhere else. So it is up to you to either feel I am deprived of this, or though I am deprived, I am compensated here. So let me develop a better quotient. I would encourage you to follow the second school rather than the first school. See, why I am emphasizing on this emotional part, as children, I want you to feel very happy. I want you to feel very proud. I want you all to feel very confident and courageous, without which you can achieve nothing. Whereas today, children are being forced to be triggered, forced to be agitated, forced to be disturbed. For anything and everything, you start raising an issue. Be calm. You can be stable only when you remain calm and remain sensible. And this is a fundamental requirement for any human being, any part of the world. I'm worried that fundamental quotient, it is getting throttled, which I'm going to discuss it in the afternoon. The entire effort of 1.5 hours on this emotional quotient is only to tell you, when I deal the second part in the afternoon, you will all know why I have laid this emphasis on the first part. That's the reason. This is an investment. This is a basic foundation to build a superstructure in the afternoon. Now, let me close with this. Now, after all, Swami Vivekananda says, finally concludes, He has not used the word constitutional morality anywhere in his speeches. He didn't conceive of it at that point of time. But he does say, these are the benefits one can derive as citizens. I've been dealing now as individuals all the while. Now, Swami Vivekananda now converts every individual as a citizen of a country and says, as a citizen, what are your responsibilities? And he says, a country, a citizen who is granted freedom without responsibilities will end up with the following. One, he will more often be an intolerant human being. Unlimited freedom without cap leads to intolerance. Lack of harmony takes away the gentleness in a human being, removes pacifying love, and takes away what is called the understanding spirit of a family or a society. So if you want a citizen, you want to be a citizen only with freedoms, no limitation, I am a free citizen of India, I can do anything I want, you will end up with these five qualities. Intolerant, lack of harmony, taking away the gentleness in the human being, removes pacifying love, and takes away the understanding spirit of fellow human beings. Is he not right? And should we lead ourselves into that? So, now we come to constitutional morality. The expression was first coined by Dr. Ambedkar. He would have never thought that this will all occupy these types of domains for a judgment. Never he would have thought in his dream, I think. Because constitutional morality in the first 5-6 decades has journeyed only in deciding democratic values, in deciding institutional values, criminalization of politics, corruption in politics. In fact, one of the judgments, should the Prime Minister be given the option, the discretion in choosing the cabinet minister, or should legislature or election commission or judiciary interfere with that decision-making process? That was the question. They said there is something called a constitutional trust on a Prime Minister. Unless you trust constitutionally your Prime Minister, how will you allow the institution to work? See, the immunity from assembly proceedings, why? They have examined it under the lens of constitutional morality. They have said the representatives who assemble in the parliament or in the state legislatures are voted to power through a process of elections by the citizens. So they voice their views in that assembly, and therefore you must allow them to voice their views with freedom of free speech and expression. You cannot apply a restraint. Therefore, they are immune from a judicial review. They have applied the doctrine of constitutional morality there. So these are the circumstances where this doctrine of constitutional morality has evolved and impregnated. But now we have borrowed this concept and say that our constitution today, only individual liberty is the only constitutional morality one has to follow. Every other form of guarantees will subsume into this. It will dissolve into this. What stands up ultimately in the constitution is only mere individual liberty. That is sacrosanct, non-compromising. Anything conflicting with that will subsume into this. And that is the constitutional morality which we need to be governed with, is the latest interpretation by the Supreme Court in 5 of its judgments. So whether they are right or it requires a revisit, let's engage into a very healthy debate in the afternoon. Any questions? Do we go with this frame of mind in the afternoon session? Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. I'll be asking three questions, sir, and most of them will be linked to the moral principles or the moral contraventions in the judiciary. First one.
Moral?
Moral contraventions, sir.
Contraventions.
Because judiciary is doing a function and they are interpreting the constitutional morality. And there are certain contraventions too. That's what I'm going to highlight here. First one is the concept of reasonableness. We know that judiciary is following the principle of statistics and precedence. Many judgments, famous judgments were given regarding the parameters of reasonableness. And it was established by higher benches too. What if these subjective nature, these subjective reasonable characters that are continuously changing with tides of time, and a lower bench wants to go against the judgment of the higher bench? That's my first question, sir. It's purely legal.
No, no, no. It is not legal. It is illegal. You can't go. I'm putting it in a milder way.
Yes.
See, we are all governed by the principles of judicial hierarchy. An incorrect decision of an appellate court binds a lower court. That's the law. Unless otherwise, the lower court is able to find out that the appellate court decision suffers from per incurium. Otherwise, right or wrong, an appellate court judgment is binding on the lower court.
But sir, certain concepts like morality, public order, these will change, these are subject to change, and it changes from decade to decade.
No, so, let it change even minute by minute. But that change has to be effected again only by, if suppose Supreme Court Constitutional Bench of 5 have pronounced a particular view, that view needs to be revisited. It has to be revisited by an appellate bench of 7. Okay. Till such time, for example, whether basic structure should be interfered or not is a mooting question now. And how does it hang? What is this? It cannot be interfered. How do you know 13 judges? It is 7:6 is one view. Another view is it is 6:6:1. So that one is on which side, nobody knows. It hangs on such a wafer-thin majority-minority view. But still, today, the law is you cannot change the basic structure of the Constitution, whether you want it or not. You can do a constitutional amendment, allow the parliament to pass and restore the states to pass. But that's a different process. Or else, these 13 judges should be referred to 15 judges and they should reverse it. Till such time, basic structure cannot be corrupted.
Yes, sir. But if these strict rules and compliances have to be followed, won't it make us evade ourselves or won't it make us move away from the role of giving rendering justice?
See, no, answer is this. Article 1, because you're a law student, Article 145 of the Constitution makes it very clear. The Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court is the ultimate interpreter of law. And what it interprets becomes law of the land under Article 141. We are governed by that constitutional principle.
Okay, sir. And advice from you, sir. I wanted to get this from you. We are facing debating minds of judges and advocates. They know that a particular concept must not be in this way, but they argue. And they also know it will be detrimental to the society if we argue in that sense. How to approach those situations, sir, as a lawyer and as a law student?
So now, see, what he is saying is, I mean, I'm basically getting irritated or frustrated at the kind of discourses happening in public domain or even in court proceedings, which does not suit certain objectives. See, I think we have very little control over it for the reason this freedom of thought and expression has gone too far in the society. So, narratives on counter-narratives over everything is the order of the day. And it is also finding tacit approval by courts. In fact, Nariman Fall, in his latest book, he talks about media hypocrisy and the hype media does whenever it wants to sensationalize an issue. There are two beautiful passages in that book. He says, this is actually a menace. But in a democratic society with very limited options available, we will rather suffer this menace, which may be 5 out of 10 times bad. After all, 5 times, it brings the guilty to the book. That is how he ends the essay. So it's a question of combination. When Nariman of his stature, of his wisdom, of his capability says, an uninhibited media, though bad, we still need to encourage it in a democratic society because occasionally they bring some good. We have to understand what he has to say, what he has in mind to say. It's like our criminal law. Let 1,000 culprits escape. One innocent should not be held guilty. Same law. It's a question of average. Democracy is always a game of numbers, game of averages. Because only thing is, but Constitution says and Supreme Court says, you can't impose a majoritarian view on the minority. And therefore, they have substituted that by saying, the best solution is make everything as an individual view. Make everything as an individual liberty. Therefore, there is no confusion. Individual liberty is sacrosanct. There is no minority view, there is no majority view. That's how they have resolved all these future disputes. Yeah. Yes. We have 7 or 8 more minutes. Up to that, I can take questions. Yeah. No, you speak because it's...
Assuming that we do achieve a situation where there is no public debate about any kind of religious practice, don't you think that will cause more agitation because it's something that's building up inside one individual? And also, being Indians that we are, to ask to hate or not to hate, and even if there is no external manifestation of any public activity against hatred or any particular religion, I think there still will be some intrinsic activity inside each individual. So what is your take on that?
No, I understand the question. See, the answer is, 30, 40 years back, when we were children like you, we never had this type of a media. And we never had this type of a technology which can project anything instantaneously and keep triggering narratives and counter-narratives, including hate. 30, 40 years back, same caste problem was there, same religious attitudes and issues were there. But it was not pitched in public domain that we keep coming to the streets every day to fight or every day to defend. This is of a recent origin. Because of the advantages of technology, because you have a platform where any damn Tom, Dick and Harry can populate any view and get away under the umbrella freedom of speech. So, is this not causing disturbance and frustration? Does it not agitate? I want to ask you a question. Whichever side you may belong to, I'm not taking a side today. I'm dealing a concept. Anything to do with religious issues coming on public on a television channel for debate, does it not force you to take some position or other naturally? This is what, in fact, I will share one thing. When I met a professor of a university some 4 months back in an airport, a professor of a university is saying this, Venkatraman, now I'm now 60 almost, I'm going to retire. What is the change in my texture of attitude? When I see somebody walking into my room or walking into the bus to travel along with me, I start identifying him unconsciously as to what religion he belongs to. This is the result. Media, debate, discourses has generated. To whom? A professor who is an intellectual, who is supposed to be very stable, who's supposed to be very neutral. He tells me, my mind does agitate and try to decipher to what religion does he belong to or she belongs to. This was something which did not happen in our times. And don't encourage this to keep happening in your times. It's not going to do good to anybody. This has not solved any problems, this is not going to restore peace. Unless you ignore, the best way to assault this is ignore it. Don't buy it. If all of you stop forwarding messages, who will put messages here? That's the point. Yeah. We are on time. One. Sir, we'll meet at 2:30 or 3:00?